हेलो
हेलो राज सर, आर
हेलो
यू गेटिंग माय वॉइस? हेलो
हेलो हेलो, आपको सुनाई दे रहा है?
यस सर, यस सर, आपका आवाज आ रहा है सर।
आ रहा है ना? फोटो भी आ रहा है?
यस सर, यस सर।
ओके
हेलो। हाँ, आपका आवाज आ रहा था सर अच्छे से, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है। हाँ ओके ओके सर, मैं आपको नहीं 2:30 को आपको ये सावन सर इंट्रोड्यूस करेंगे 2:30 को। हाँ, फिर आपको उनका इंट्रोडक्शन होने के बाद यू हैव टू स्टार्ट योर सेशन। ओके सर। हाँ ओके, एंड योर सेशन विल बी एंड एट 3:20। हेलो ओके सर, ओके थैंक यू सर, बाय। हेलो
हेलो सावन सर।
हेलो
हेलो हेलो। यस सर यू आर ऑडिबल। हेलो
हेलो।
यस सर यू आर ऑडिबल, यू कैन स्टार्ट।
ओके ओके। हेलो
हेलो।
हेलो
हेलो।
सोनोनी सर,
सावन सर यू स्टार्ट,
हाँ,
यू आर ऑडिबल,
ओके
यू स्टार्ट।
ओके। गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल। आई एम डॉक्टर जय सिंह सावंत, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिलोसॉफी। आई एम एक्सट्रीमली डिलाइटेड टू इंट्रोड्यूस अवर रिसर्च पर्सन डॉक्टर अनिर्बन दास, असोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन सेंट्रल यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ Tibetan Studies, Sarnath, Varanasi. He was an assistant professor at Department of Pali and Buddhist Literature at Savitribai Phule, Pune University. He has worked as visiting faculty at Indology Section, Department of Asian Studies in Institute for Cross-Cultural and Regional Studies, University of Copenhagen, Denmark. He has been teaching Sanskrit to international students coming from Australia, Belgium, Bhutan, Denmark, France, Germany, Britain, Japan since last 7 to 8 years. He was research fellow at Comprehensive Center of Othani University, Japan. His interest area is philosophy of language, grammar, paleography, in Buddhism, Kashmiri Sages, and his area of specialization is paleography, including Brahmi, Kharosthi, Old Devanagari, Gurumukhi, Modi, Pandavani. He has completed doctoral research in Sanskrit at University of Pune. He published 22 research papers and articles in reputed journals like Languages in India. His another research project is going on in Buddhist Academy, China. Since 2017, he has been working as a linguistic consultant for Muktabodha Indological Research Institute, U.S.
हेलो 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 आई थिंक कनेक्टेड प्रॉब्लम एट द एंड ऑफ सावन सर. हेलो 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 सावन सर. हेलो 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 सावन सर. हेलो
हेलो
हेलो हेलो
सर. हेलो
हेलो सर, यू आर ऑडिबल. हेलो
हेलो
हेलो हेलो.
हाँ, सो नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर अनिर्बल दास टू एक्सप्रेस हिज वैल्यूएबल थॉट्स ऑन टॉपिक बुद्धिस्ट फिलोसॉफी एंड लिटरेचर. प्लीज
हेलो अनिर्बल सर. हेलो अनिर्बल सर, यू आर नॉट ऑडिबल. हेलो
इज ओके, कैन यू हियर मी?
यस 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 सर, यस सर. सर प्लीज स्टार्ट
नाउ.
सर प्लीज स्टार्ट योर सेशन, यू आर ऑडिबल क्लियरली.
यस ओके
ओके ओके.
आई एम अनिर्बल दास फ्रॉम वाराणसी, एक्सटेंडिंग माय ग्रेटिट्यूड टू डॉक्टर स्वाति ओहल, प्रिंसिपल एंड कन्वीनर, फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू बी द पार्ट ऑफ दिस इंटरनेशनल ई कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑन reciprocal interface of literature and social science. I am very thankful to Dr. Gandhi Dehuri, the HOD, Department of Philosophy, Ismail Yusuf College, Mumbai, for giving me the topic to speak on Buddhist philosophy and literature. As you know, it is a very vast topic to cover in a limited time. So, I would like to share a couple of my thoughts with you. And again, I'm extremely thankful to the organizing committee for this wonderful e-conference. I would like to share my PPT. Can you see the PPT now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, ओम नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स. नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स. नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स. The topic has given to me Buddhist philosophy and literature. So the definition of philosophy, from the Greek word philosophia, love of wisdom, is the study of general and fundamental questions about the existence, knowledge, value, reason, mind, and language. Such questions are often posed as problems to be studied or resolved. Philosophical methods include questioning, critical discussion, rational argument, and systematic presentation. Come to the second point, that is the literature. So the literature, from the Latin root, literia, derived from the litera, letter, or handwriting. Literature is a body or collection of written work. More restrictively, literature refers to writing considered to be an art form or any single writing deemed to be have artistic or intellectual value, and sometimes deploys some language in ways that differ from ordinary usage. The concept has changed meaning over time to include texts that are spoken or sung or oral literature and non-written verbal art forms. Literature is classified according to whether it is a fiction or non-fiction, and whether it is poetry or prose. So now, come to the basic idea of Buddhist philosophy. So Buddhist philosophy refers to the philosophical investigations and systems of inquiry that developed among various Buddhist schools in India following the parinirvana of the Buddha, and later period it spread throughout Asia. The Buddhist path combines both philosophical reasoning and meditation. If you look at the historical phases, the development, the philosophical development of Buddhism or Buddhist philosophy, I would like to quote a Western scholar's idea, his statements. Ewart Ponje splits the development of Indian Buddhist philosophy into three phases. The phases of the original doctrine derived from the oral traditions, that is called this Buddha Vachana, that originated during the lifetime of the Buddha and are common to all later sects of the Buddhism. The second phase concern non-Mahayana scholastic Buddhism, as evident in the Abhidharma text beginning in the 3rd century BCE, that features scholastic reworking and semantic classification of the material in the sutras. The third phase of the development of Indian Buddhist philosophy concerns Mahayana, the metaphysical Buddhism, belonging in the late 1st century CE, which emphasizes the monastic life and the path of Bodhisattva. You can see this picture, and this Buddhism started from Magadha. And you can see the whole area in the map. The Buddhism has spreaded in deep time to time with different languages, different scripts, different scholars. So the teaching of Buddha, the Four Noble Truths, contain the essence of Buddha's teaching. It was these four principles that the Buddha came to understand during his meditation under the Bodhi tree in Bodh Gaya, the present day. The Buddha is often compared to a physician. In the first two Noble Truths, he diagnosed the problem of suffering and identified its cause like a doctor. The third Noble Truth is the realization that there is a cure. The fourth Noble Truth, in which the Buddha set out the eightfold path, is the prescription, the way to achieve a release from the suffering, going towards the nirvana. Look at, in Buddhist philosophy, there are many things, there are many concepts, and which I'm not going to discuss. Couple of things I would like to tell all of you. So Buddhist philosophy, that is the teaching of Buddha, Sakyamuni, and the period is 480 to 400 BCE. In Buddhism, the three marks of existence are there. In Pali Tripitaka, they call Tilakshana, Trilakshana. What are they? The impermanence, anicca, anitya, dukkha, unsatisfactoriness or suffering, and non-self, anatta, sarve dharma nishvabhava. So sarva dharma, everything, there is no swabhava. So we are going towards the sunyata. So sarva dharma nishvabhava. So now, little bit about more discussion about the Noble Truth. It is a very famous, popular concept of Buddhism. So in fourth Noble Truth, four Noble Truths, Dukkha, Samudaya, Nirodha, and Marga, Magga or Marga. The truth of suffering, the truth of origin of suffering, the truth of end of suffering, the truth of path to end of suffering. So these are the four steps. So I would like to discuss a little bit more about this four types of dukkha. So the first is the truth of suffering. That is called dukkha. It means Buddha said in different contexts, in different places, birth is suffering, aging is suffering, death is suffering, sorrow is suffering, lamentation is suffering, physical pain is suffering, mental displeasure also suffering, despair is also suffering, association with hateful is suffering, separation from beloved is suffering, not getting what you desire is also suffering, five aggregates also are suffering. It means priyasa biyoga. If your beloved one is separate from you, it is a suffering. So priyasa biyoga, he said, separation from the beloved one is also suffering. So it is the broader criteria of the suffering. Then come to the second, the samudaya, the origin, the truth of the origin of the suffering, that is called trishna, desire, craving. So there are three types of trishna: kama trishna, sensual craving, bhava trishna, craving for external existence, vibhava trishna, craving for non-existence, self-annihilation. And these are the second suffering of the Arya Satya. Then the Nirodha. So Nirodha is sense and ending for this dukkha can be attained by the eliminating all kinds of defilements, all kinds of attachments, all kinds of desire and craving. So come to the last part of this Four Noble Truth, that is the magga, marga, the path of eightfold path is the means to end of this dukkha. See this picture. So this noble eight path, the first one is sammaditthi, know the truth. Sammaditthi means samyak drishti. In Sanskrit we say samyak drishti. According to Buddhist teaching, the Buddha never intended his follower to believe his teaching blindly, but to practice them and judge for themselves whether they were true. So that is called samyak drishti or sammaditthi. Come to the right intention. Samma sankalpa, sankalpa, samma sankalpa. So it is a commitment to cultivate the right attitudes. That is called samma sankalpa. Then come to the right speech, samma vacha, samyak vak. Speaking truthfully, avoiding slander, gossip, and abusing speech. Nowadays, we are very much doing all these things. So we have to avoid such kind of things. So we have to always be with the right speech. Then come to the right action. Samma karmata, behaving peacefully, harmoniously, and refraining from the stealing, killing in sensual pleasures. So that you have to be. Then come to right livelihood. Samma ajiva, avoiding making a living in the ways that cause harm, such as exploiting people or killing animals or trading in intoxicant or weapons. Then come to the right effort, samma vyayama, right effort. That means avoiding samma vyayama, cultivating the positive states of mind, filling oneself from evil and unwholesome states and preventing them arising in future. Then the seventh one, the right concentration, practicing meditation, samma sati, is a very important for all of us. Developing awareness of the body, sensation, feeling, and the state of mind. If you realize every day, if you look at your mind, state of mind, and you analyze yourself, so many things you can do in a very good manner. Now, the last one, the right mindfulness. Samva Samadhi, developing the mental focus necessary for this awareness. These eight stages can be grouped into wisdom. That is called right understanding and intention, ethical conduct, right speech, action, and livelihood, and meditation, right effort, mindfulness, and concentration. The Buddha described the eightfold path as the means of enlightenment, like a raft for crossing a river. Once one has reached to opposite shore, one no longer needs the raft and can leave it behind. Come to the next slide. This is a very important incident. When Buddha, after enlightenment, Buddha came to Sarnath. Basically, he came to Varanasi. And that time, Varanasi was a very learned place, and people were discussing, traditional scholars were there, and he never allowed him to give his understanding to the world. So he moved from Varanasi, Ganga, to the Sarnath, around 7-8 kilometers from that place. And then in Sarnath, he gave, this is the place, so he gave his first sermon. And the first sermon actually with his five disciples. And he saw his five disciples nearby Sarnath. There is another place, there is a Chaukhandi Stupa. So he found them there. So he started his Dhamma Chakra Sutra and the first, motion of the wheel of the Dhamma Sutra, Dharma Chakra Parivartan Sutra. So this is the place, and this is the mudra of that sutra while he was teaching. And you can see the Dhamma Chakra. And this is the picture of this Nalanda Mahavihar. The Nalanda Mahavihar means, I'm talking about not the present one, the oldest one, the Nalanda Mahavihar we had. So this is the logo of that university. So now we can come to, because this is the philosophy part, very shortly I told all of you, I expressed my understanding a little bit, and then we can come to the literature part. So if you look at Buddha's life, see, geographically, Buddha taught in Magadha, one of the 16 Janapada. But the four most important place in his life are all outside of it. So it is likely that he taught in several closely related dialects, that is of Middle Indo-Aryan dialects, and which had a highly mutual intelligibility. Still the scholars are working, which language Buddha was speaking. When you're talking about the literature, definitely in the beginning there was oral literature, and from oral it came to the written form. So they are using the language. So we should know what language the Buddha was using for this conversation. So you can see in the map, so in the Lumbini, it is his born place. And then he came to Bodh Gaya for the knowledge. Then he came to Sarnath to spread that knowledge, whatever he obtained. Then Kushinara is the last life, his last time for Nirvana. So these are the places. So you can imagine which language he was using, so that the people in Sarnath, people in Bodh Gaya, people in Lumbini, people in Kushinara, they can understand it. So it is very interesting to know the language Buddha was speaking. Some people say Buddha was speaking in Magadhi. Some people say Buddha speaking in Pali. So there, he was speaking one kind of Prakrit. So Pali is one of the oldest Prakrit. So now I can tell you one incident. While Buddha was teaching, two Brahmins came to Buddha and said, Bhante bhikkhu nana nama nana gota nana chajja nana kula pavajjita te sakaya nirutiya buddha vachanam dusyanti. Come to the word dusyanti. Dusyanti means pollute. Buddha vachanam dusyanti. They are polluting the speech of Buddha. Why? The two Brahmins came to Buddha. They said, your followers, the bhikshu, the followers, nana nama, different name, nana gota, they are from different gotra, nana chaja, nana kula pavajjita, they are from different family, different kula, and they are polluting your speech. Again they said, handa mayam bhante buddha vachanam chandosa aropama. So we have to convert the buddha vachana to chandas. It may be Vedic Sanskrit or classical Sanskrit, Sanskrit specially. Buddha never allowed. And this passage is from Chullabhaga. Buddha never allowed his disciples not put to his word into the Vedic language. Who does so would commit a sin. He authorized the monks to learn his words, each in his own dialect. Then the question is raised, what was his own dialect during his period? It was a controversial issue among the scholars. This is still a subject of discussion, which is not a purpose of this presentation, but I just told you about that Buddha used many dialects. He said, na bhikkhave, in the last two lines, na bhikkhave buddha vachanam chandaso aropetavam. So buddha vachana, you should not convert to the chandas, the Vedic language. So it never allowed. So we have a reference from the Tripitaka. So language always has importance. Look, the Asokan inscriptions, they are in Pali. So language is Pali, a different kind of Prakrit. So language has the vital role to preserve the philosophy, to preserve the literature. So now look at here, Buddhist religious literature have been preserved in four Indic languages. The standard Sanskrit, that is the classical Sanskrit, Panini Sanskrit, and Pali and Prakrit, and also Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit. जो प्राकृत है और पाली और संस्कृत, ये जो तीनों है लैंग्वेज है, ये हाइब्रिड उससे अलग है. मतलब ये तीनों का मिक्सचर को हम हाइब्रिड कह सकते हैं. ये हाइब्रिड जो है ये नाइदर पाली नर प्राकृत नर संस्कृत. इट इज ए मिक्सचर ऑफ ऑल दिस लैंग्वेजेस. सो देयर वाज अ ट्रेडिशन, बिकॉज जैसे हमको भी पता चला कि बुद्ध ने कभी अपने भिक्षुगण को संस्कृत में बोलने के लिए, संस्कृत में करने के लिए मना किया. उन्होंने प्राकृत को किया. ऐसे क्यों किया प्राकृत भाषा को? क्योंकि वो चाहते थे ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोग बुद्धिज्म को, बुद्ध के दर्शन को जाने सीखे. तो प्राकृत लैंग्वेज वॉज द मदर लैंग्वेज एट दैट पीरियड. सो पीपुल आर यूजिंग दैट लैंग्वेज. सो बुद्ध प्रीफर टू स्पीक एंड अलाउड all his followers to give talk on that language. And we have another reference. There is a scholar named Vinitadeva around 8th century, because we are talking about the literature. So the Buddhist literature of Sarvastivadin was in Sanskrit. Mahasangika, there are different schools. So Sarvastivadin is a school. So they were using Sanskrit. And Mahasangikas were using Prakrit. And Samvitiya was using Apabhramsa. And the Sarvastivadin is Paisachi. You can see there is another Paisachi. Paisachi is a Prakrit. Actually, Prakrit, bahut sare बोली को लेकर के ये प्राकृत भाषा है। इसमें मागधी, अर्धमागधी, सौरसेनी, पैचासी एंड महाराष्ट्री, सो मेनी डायलेक्ट्स आर देयर। नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू टॉक अबाउट द अर्ली बुद्धिस्ट टेक्स्ट। द अर्ली बुद्धिस्ट टेक्स्ट वेयर पास्ड डाउन ओरली इन मिडिल इंडो आर्यन लैंग्वेजेस कॉल्ड प्राकृत। When we say प्राकृत, we are safe। जब हम प्राकृत बोलते हैं तो उसमें कहने की जरूरत नहीं है, क्योंकि प्राकृत में सब आ जाते हैं। जैसे मैंने अभी कहा मागधी, अर्धमागधी, पैसाची, सौरसेनी सब आ जाते हैं, including गांधारी languages, because we have गांधारी धम्मपद in गांधारी language, in गांधारी प्राकृत, from गांधार। The early Magadhi language, Pali, actually Pali is a, people very much know about the Pali language, it is a famous language now. But Pali was actually a monastic language. When we are talking about the literature, the Theravada literature written in Pali, so it was a monastic language. Suppose we are talking something in the house, but we never use that in the official language. So Pali was purely a monastic language. And as I said, these texts were later compiled into canons and written down in manuscripts. For example, the Pali canon was preserved in Sri Lanka, where it was first written down in 1st century BCE. The Theravada tradition. The Theravada tradition has an extensive commentarial literature, much of which is still not transcribed. These are attributed to the scholars working in Sri Lanka, such as Buddhaghosa around 5th century, Dhammapala, there are sub-commentaries, Tikka and Anutika. Commentaries on commentaries, and Buddhaghosa was the author of the Visuddhimagga, the Path of Purification, which is a manual of doctrine and practice according to Mahavihara tradition in Sri Lanka. It's a very famous text, Visuddhimagga, the purification, the path of purification. A similar shutter work of Visuddhimagga also available. Another highly influential Pali Theravada work is Abhidhammata Sangaha. So it is around 11th to 12th century, which is widely used to teach Abhidhamma, and Buddhaghosa is known to word from Buddhist commentaries in the Sri Lanka and Sinhali languages, which are actually now lost. In Sri Lanka literature, in Sinhali vernacular contents, many Buddhist works, including classical Sinhali poems, such as Muba Devata, this is the story of Bodhisattva, the king of Mukhadeva, and also around 12th century, and Sasavadatta, means it is Sasavadan, means Bodhisattva birth as a hair, Sasa, around 12th century. There are many texts. So now you can see this picture. This is a painting, and it is in Kalaniya Rajamahavihara in Sri Lanka. You can see, here is the Buddhaghosa. So Buddhaghosa, Venerable Buddhaghosa, Pali commentary upper to the Mahathera. So this is the picture, how you can see, actually this is a picture, it is a palm leaf manuscripts, because most of the manuscripts of the Buddhist literature in Theravada countries, they use the palm leaves. And Mahayana Sutra, around beginning of the Common Era, a new genre of sutra literature begins to be written with a focus on a bodhisattva ideal, commonly known as Mahayana, the great vehicle, or the bodhisattva yana, the bodhisattva vehicle. The earliest of these sutra do not call themselves Mahayana, but use the term Vaipulya, the extensive sutras, or maybe Gambhira, the profound sutras. Many of these Mahayana sutras were written in Sanskrit, as I told you, classical Sanskrit, in also hybrid forms in classical Sanskrit, and then later translated into Tibetan and Chinese. Buddhist canon, the Kangyur and Tangyur, and Thaisa Tripitaka respectively, because Kangyur is a kind of collection of Buddhist canon in Tibetan and Thaisa Tripitaka in Chinese, which then developed their own textual histories. Sanskrit had been adopted by the Buddhists in North India during the Kushan period, and the Sanskrit Buddhist literature became dominant tradition in Buddhist India until the decline of Buddhism there. The Mahayana Sutras are also generally regarded as Mahayana tradition as being more profound than the Sravaka texts, as well as generating more spiritual merit and benefits. Thus, they are seen as superior and more virtuous to non-Mahayana Sutra and Mahayana Sutra traditionally, and considered as Mahayana Buddhist to be the word of Buddha. It is believed that there are 84,000 of Sutra texts. And some of the examples, I cannot read all the names, and I can share this PPT to the principal madam. So Ashtasahasrika Prajna Paramita Sutra is a very famous sutra, the earliest sutra in Buddhist sutra, Vajra Chedika, and so many sutras. Come to Indian treatise, it means talking about the philosophical element, because Buddha gave his sermon and talks. Later period, there are so many philosophical literature compiled. So Nagarjuna, the Mula Madhyamika Karika is the magnum opus, and Middle Way is the seminal text of Madhyamika philosophy. Various other authors of the Madhyamika school followed him and wrote commentaries to his texts and other treatises. Then we have Yogacara Bhumi, another larger treatise, focuses the yogic practice of a Yogacara school. Then we have Asanga, then Abhidharma Samuchaya, Mahayana Sangraha, and we have so many scholars about the Yogacara and Alak, the other schools. We can see the Mahayana Sutra Alankara and Abhisamya Alankara, and we have Asanga's brother Vasubandhu. He wrote a large number of texts, and including Triswabhava Nirdesha, Bhimsika, Trimsika, all are the philosophical texts, and also Abhidharma Kosa Bhasya. This is the root text of Buddhist philosophy. In 9th century, the Indian Buddhist Shantideva produced two texts, Bodhicharya Avatara, has been a strong influence in many schools of Mahayana. It is notable, a favorite text of the 14th Dalai Lama. Dingnaga is a logician, is a philosopher, is associated with the school of Buddhist logic that tried to establish which texts were valid sources of knowledge of epistemology. He wrote Pramana Samuchaya, and later Dharmakirti wrote Pramana Vartika, which was a commentary and reworking of the Dingnaga treatise. Come to the last phase, textual tradition of Buddhist philosophy or literature, that is the Vajrayana. So Vajrayana is the system of Buddhist thought based on a set of texts that are referred from Buddhist tantras. These texts are appeared in North India between 7th to 8th century. Vajrayana throughout the practice first influenced Buddhist practitioner in North India and then spread to China, Mongolia, Tibet. From China, the Vajrayana text practices transmitted to Korea and Japan. The Vajrayana path builds a foundation of Mahayana school. Professor Rupert Gethin states that Vajrayana is a particular approach to the practice of the Buddhist path occurring within the general Mahayana philosophical framework. The tantra, which focused on ritual practice and yogic techniques such as use of mantras, dharinis, mandala, mudra, and fire offering. I can show you one mandala. So it is a vam. It is written in vam. So it is a Vajra Varahi mandala. You can see the literature in the form of the mandala. And then this is very interesting. It is a mantra. And this mantra is a Kala Chakra mantra. You can see, actually the written is Om Ahum O Ham Cha Ma La Var Ra Ya Hum Fat. So everything is there. And this is a writing style. It is the hidden mantras, because the Vajracharya, the Tantric master, they are using such kind of hidden mantras in between the text, in between the manuscript. So it is not easy to decipher a general person. So all the letters are, you can go to the next, we can see it. So for all of you, I prepared to show them. You can see this is a Chandra Bindu, this is the Ha, this is the Ma, Va, Ya, Ra, La, Ksha. So this is the mantra. So Yakar is a Vayumandala. रकार जो है अग्निमंडल है, वकार जो है जलमंडल है, लकार भूमि मंडल है, मकार मेरुमंडल है, दीज आर द विसर्ग जो है वो सूर्य है, एंड नाद विंद, दीज आर द स्टाइल ऑफ राइटिंग मंत्र. And many early Buddhist tantric terms, action, like Kriya, Tantra, these are the actually tantric texts. So I think just I can tell you, there are many tantric texts and mostly this Kriya, Yoga Tantra and Acharya Tantra are very famous. And now we can see the script and the manuscript of Buddhist literature. It is very interesting to know because Buddhism started from Magadha and spread from Magadha, spread to Central Asia, China and other countries, spread to Sri Lanka, from Sri Lanka to Myanmar, from Myanmar to Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, everywhere. So script and the manuscript of Buddhist literature. So they are using different scripts. They are using, because nowadays we have printed books and we are using the printed books, and all the printed books actually based on these manuscripts. Whenever you're talking about the literature, these are the real literature actually. The professors, the scholars, they edited, and then we have the book. So we can see, this is the picture of a Burmese manuscript, Kamma Vachya, and it's Burmese script with Pali language. And another side, this Jatakamala, from Cambodia, from Khmer script. So different scripts were used to write down the manuscripts. Then we can see the Sinhali script, Pali manuscript in Sinhali script. It is a palm leaf manuscript, okay? And then this is a manuscript, Buddhist manuscript written in Ranjana script. And this is a script, actually very beautiful script, the Buddhist literature. Mostly in Nepal, actually the people are using different kind of scripts, and mostly the Mahayana texts are well preserved in Nepal. How? Because when the Nalanda University destroyed, then the scholar went to Nepal, and Nepal was the halting place for all the scholars to prepare the Buddhist literature and going to Tibet. So mostly Mahayana manuscripts are available in Nepal, the literature. And I would like to talk about little bit about the Nalanda monastery education system. Because in our hand, so many literature handed down to us in different form, in different language, in different scripts. And the credit goes to definitely Buddha and his followers. And Nalanda's, there are many university contribution is there, but Nalanda is the greatest learning center from 5th century to 12th century CE. And we can see there are 17 scholars. There may be more, definitely. But the 17 scholars are very famous. They have a very quite good contribution to the Buddhist philosophy. Nagarjuna, 2nd century. Aryadeva, 3rd century. Asanga, 3rd century. Vasubandhu, 4th century. Dingnag, 6th century, Gunaprabha, 9th century, Sakaprabha, 6th century, Dharmakirti, 6th century, Buddhapalita, 4th century, 5th century in between, Bhava Viveka, 5th century, Chandrakirti, 6th century, Santarakhita, 8th century, Kamalasila, 8th century, Harivedra, 7th century, Vimukti Sena, 6th century, Santideva, 8th century, and Atisa, the last scholar, around 10th century. So there is the greater contribution to the Buddhist literature of this scholar. There are many. Due to the time limitation, I have just given little. And I would like to conclude my lecture with statement of Huensang. We know Huensang visited India. He visited Nalanda. And he entered to Nalanda monastery. He has to face scholarly questions. That was the Dwarapala, jo hote the, wo bhi Sanskrit aur Buddhism ke acche pandit hote the. Jab Huensang प्रवेश करना चाहते थे महाविहार में, तो उनको प्रश्न पूछा गया, वो प्रश्न का उत्तर दिए, वो उत्तर देने के बाद उनको जाना, मतलब अंदर वो जा सके। अंदर जा करके वो जो लिखे, मैं आप लोग सबको बताना चाहता हूं, व्हाट ही सेड इन हिज रिपोर्ट। ही सेड द डे इज नॉट, द डे इज नॉट सफिशियंट फॉर आस्किंग एंड आंसरिंग प्रोफाउंड क्वेश्चन। From morning till night, they engage, they mean the monks, they engage in discussions. The old and the young mutually help one another. Those who cannot discuss questions out of Tripitaka are still esteemed and are obliged to hide themselves for shame. Without any hesitation, we may be inspired by the footstep of monastic education system. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your colorful, interesting, and informative lecture, which gives us a lot of information and knowledge about Buddhist philosophy and literature. I also take this opportunity to thank our principal, Dr. Swati Vawal Madam, and conference coordinator Dr. Vijay Narkade sir for arranging this e-conference. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And now I hand over the session to Kalpana Pavaskar Madam.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I think my time is over, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay. So can I sign out? Or any question or anything I have to answer?
No, sir. There is no question in the chat box.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Madam, please start.
Okay, thank you, sir. Good evening, all. We would like to share the message of our former principal, Madam Dr. Devyani Ben Dave. The principal, Dr. Devyani Dave, Madam, is a highly respectable and popular personality among the students, staffs, and locals of Jogeshwari. Madam has joined as a principal in mid-1990s by her excellent administrative skills, caring and understanding ways led the institution on the path of progress. A dashing, fearless lady who protected the lives of her staff members staying in the college campus in those dark days of her life of 1992 riots. Madam always withstood in the time of crisis with the students and the staff members, nurtured liberal and secular ideas by her actions. Madam has penned a number of books in Gujarati, a loving, motherly teacher and principal. We all are blessed by her motherly care. By her sheer hard work, determination and dedication and firm leadership, changed the world of Ismail Yusuf College, bringing respect and fame in to the institutions. Now let us hear the message of former principal, Madam Dr. Devyani Dave, Madam.
Start.
Congratulations and my best wishes to IY College for RELITS 2020. I am proud to have been associated with this institution as a principal, known for its great culture and beautiful natural surrounding. I had joined Ismail College for the first time in the year of 1963 as a professor of Gujarati, and later during my second coming in 1990 as the principal. This was the time when IY College was celebrating Diamond Jubilee function, and we have invited then Government of Maharashtra, Mr. C. Subramanian, as the chief guest. During my tenure, we set up the computer. During my tenure, we set up the computer center with the help of Maths department, and one floor in the Commerce building was constructed. We had also worked out a scheme proposed for IY Krida Sankul and submitted same to the government, and which was later completed. During the unfortunate time of Mumbai communal riots, the surrounding area to the college was highly disturbed, and entire staff residing in the campus showed an amazing courage, brotherhood and unity like a one big family. Such is and was the culture of Ismail College. Personally, for me, IY College is like my Mahe, Piyarwar. I have stayed in the campus in the principal bungalow with my family. We used to have family events and inviting all the staff residing in the campus. They have helped me a lot and they enjoyed my events also. My good wishes to the staff and students and bright future for Ismail College.
Thank you, Dave Madam, for being with us. It's a blessing for us. We all valued you very much and sure to be with us at the time of celebration of centenary of our college. Thank you very much once again, Madam. Thank you. Another important personality is Dr. Arvind Ganachari, sir, would like to share his experiences and best wishes. Dr. Arvind Ganachari, sir, was the former head of the Department of History, Ismail Yusuf College, and retired as a head Department of History, University of Mumbai in the year 2013. Dr. Ganachari, sir, is an excellent teacher and intellect and historian of a national and international repute. Recently, sir has published his book entitled The Indians in the First World War, The Missing Link. Sir is closely associated with his students and his colleagues and a real treasure house of knowledge. Now I request that message of Dr. Arvind Ganachari, sir, to be played.
Namaskar. Arvind Ganachari, historian, former professor and head at the University of Mumbai. To me, Ismail, anything talking about Ismail is talking about homecoming. I spent my 27 years of life, of productive life, in Ismail. I joined the college on 11th of July, 1972. Replacing Professor Naik, who joined the University of Mumbai. I had a good fortune of having very good colleagues, most eminent, formidable, towering personalities. The very first principal under whom I worked had two doctorates, and one of the best intellectuals I first began with. There was Professor Kulsum Parekh, late professor and later on principal, Kejo Purohit, who better known as president of Sahitya Sammelan and as Shantaram, Professor Shankar Vaidya, Professor G.S. Ghai, and Professor Man Sharmani, who were experts on and best scholars of Persian, Professor Gulab Tai Dawane, and very eminent Sanskritist, Indologist, Professor Abdul Sattar Dalvi and his wife Maimuna, both Urdu scholars. Professor K. My own head, K.S. Patankar, who after retirement wrote prolific, as historian under the name Arun Sarathy, and many others, including Professor Dadarkar, who taught Arabic. These, apart from these, I had one of the best colleagues in during my period of 27 years. I had Professor Marathi Department Head, Professor Surega Samnesh, Professor Zahir Ali, Professor Flori D'Souza, Professor Halim Naktare, and a wonderful principal, Dr. Devani Dave, and Dr. Mrs. Kanta Mehta. Ismail had a very formidable academic history. The very first principal of Ismail Yusuf College was from 1930 to 1954. 24 years he was principal, Professor Rehman. His successor, Professor Anil Ahmad, whom I had the good fortune of meeting in 1981 during 50 years Golden Jubilee of the college, one of the best historians of this country, and who wrote a foreword to Professor Irfan Habib's father's book, Professor Muhammad Habib. There was Pushi Rege, eminent principal, eminent poet in Marathi literature, who wrote his very best magnum opus, Savitri, at the principal's bungalow. There was Vimadi Patwardhan. There was D.K. Banker, father of Borkar. And all these people really adorned the history of this college. And many more. This time is very short. I cannot just go on giving you, we don't have that much of time. But I am very happy that the college is having a webinar on reciprocal interfaces of literature and social sciences. It's interdisciplinarity. Being an interdisciplinary, what pleases me the most is to breaking of shackles of disciplinary boundaries. These are the days we talk about Annals School and others, where we talk of relation between history and literature, history and sociology, history and political science, and literature and political science, and everything like this. I'm very happy that such a webinar is being conducted. There are eminent scholars. I have gone through the list and I find eminent scholars going to make their presentations in the conference. I wish the conference the very best. And I hope the proceedings of this would come out in a volume. All the very best. Thank you very much. May the webinar be a success. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your best wishes. Ganachari sir is also highly appreciated the efforts put by our principal, Madam Dr. Swati Bhavar, and her team for conducting the conference and its grand success. Thank you very much, sir. Now, without taking much of the time, I would convey the message of Srimati Saraswati Dubey, former faculty member of the Department of Philosophy. Madam has attended the 3 days conference of our college and congratulated our principal, Madam Dr. Swati Bhavar, and the members of the Faculty of Arts and her team for the success of this international e-conference. Thank you very much. Now I'm handing over to Dr. Narkhede sir. Thank you.
Good evening, respected dignitaries and delegates. We have 2 participants connected with us to express their views about the conference. The first is Mr. Kevin Salve, and second is Ms. Rashmi Jeswar. I request both of them to express their views. Thank you. Kevin Salve.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Kevin Salve. I'm working as an assistant teacher at RBRS Junior College of Arts, Commerce and Science. I'm grateful to the organizers of this conference who has given me this opportunity to share my thoughts and my experience about this conference. In the time of this pandemic situation, where many things in the world has come to halt, but education is a light that breaks the darkness around us. Nowadays, several webinars are organized, but this conference is special as it has brought the arts, literature and social science faculty members, teachers and students under one roof. This conference has given us a golden opportunity to come across different scholars of respective disciplines. The display of their presentation has given us a clear and depth picture of a perfect and well-researched research papers. On the first day, we learn how literature can be connected with philosophy and psychology. Dr. Kishore Gaikwad sir has given a vivid picture about tribal memory, tribal folk literature in the light of literature with special respect to Gond community. Dr. Sandesh Wagh sir has given us a vivid picture and briefed us about the major contribution of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, his literary works in the development of social sciences. On the second day, we learned how the literature of Arabic, Urdu and Gujarati can be important in the study of social sciences. And today, that is the third day, we came across different trends in literary research, and we also saw Buddhist philosophy in the light of literature. This conference has given me the golden opportunity to write my first ever research paper. The title of my research paper is Tribal History in the Light of Fiction. My research is basically an assessment of three novels that has brought tribal life into literary world. I would again like to thank the Honorable Principal of Ismail Yusuf College and her team who has come up with this great initiative. Thank you.
नमस्कार स्माइल यूसुफ महाविद्यालय द्वारा आयोजित तीन दिवसीय ई संगोष्ठी के आयोजकों को मैं धन्यवाद करती हूं जिन्होंने मुझे अपनी बात कहने का अवसर दिया। स्माइल यूसुफ महाविद्यालय की प्राचार्य डॉक्टर स्वाति भावल मैडम का भी मैं आभार व्यक्त करती हूं जिन्होंने महाविद्यालय के द्वारा यह तीन दिवसीय ई संगोष्ठी का आयोजन सम्पन्न कराया। ई संगोष्ठी का विषय पारस्परिक संबंध था तथा समाज का लेखा जोखा है। किसी भी राष्ट्र या सभ्यता की जानकारी उसके साहित्य से प्राप्त होती है, साथ ही साहित्य लोक जीवन का अभिन्न अंग है, इस बात से हम सभी परिचित हैं। ई संगोष्ठी के प्रथम दिन के प्रथम सत्र में उपसाला यूनिवर्सिटी स्वीडन से डॉक्टर हिंस वेस्लर सर ने हमें इस बात से परिचित कराया कि आधुनिकता साहित्य में कितना व्यापक है, खासकर हिंदी साहित्य का बोलबाला आज दुनिया भर में मौजूद है। यह बात उन्होंने हमें बताई। वहीं दूसरी वक्ता मॉरिसस से थी डॉक्टर श्रुति रघुनंदन। इन्होंने साहित्य और मनोविज्ञान इस विषय पर अपना मंतव्य प्रस्तुत किया। इन्होंने हमें बताया कि साहित्य मानवीय संवेदनाओं से जुड़ा है, समाज की हर वर्ग की व्याख्या करता है, हर वर्ग की भावनाएं साहित्य में समाहित होती हैं, इनसे साहित्य कभी भी अछूता नहीं रहता। वहीं पीएल श्राफ कॉलेज के ज्ञानेश्वर भोसले सर ने साहित्य और तत्व ज्ञान एक अनुबंधन इस विषय पर अपनी बात कही। इन्होंने स्पष्ट कहा कि मनुष्य, जगत, समाज, इन तीनों का समावेश साहित्य में पाया जाता है, इनके बिना साहित्य अधूरा है। वहीं डॉक्टर संदेश वाघ जी ने सामाजिक विज्ञान में डॉक्टर आम्बेडकर का योगदान कितना गहरा है यह स्पष्ट किया। आम्बेडकर समाज से जुड़े थे, इसीलिए साहित्य के अंतर्गत समाज की छोटी से छोटी समस्याओं को उजागर करने का आम्बेडकर जी ने प्रयत्न किया और उनके इस योगदान को साहित्य जगत में हमेशा याद किया जाएगा, हमेशा अविस्मरणीय रहेगा। वहीं मुंबई विश्वविद्यालय के अरबी विभाग के डॉक्टर मोहम्मद सर ने द्वितीय सत्र में अरबी साहित्य में निहित समाज के विभिन्न पहलुओं से हमें अवगत कराया, समाज से जुड़ी समस्याओं को सटीक ढंग से प्रस्तुत किया और समाज की हकीकत से हम सभी को रूबरू कराने का प्रयत्न किया। वहीं मैसूर विश्वविद्यालय की उर्दू विभाग की प्रोफेसर रफ्तुनिशा बेगम मैडम ने अपने विषय अदब व इल्मे नफसियत की बात बताई। जिंदगी में अदब का महत्व हमेशा रहेगा, समाज में इसकी मौजूदगी हम नकार नहीं सकते। उन्होंने स्पष्ट अपने मंतव्य में इसकी व्याख्या की। वहीं मुंबई यूनिवर्सिटी की गुजराती विभाग की विभागाध्यक्ष उर्वशी बहन पांड्या जी ने गुजराती साहित्य तत्व ज्ञान इस विषय पर अपना मंतव्य प्रस्तुत करते हुए बताया कि मध्यकालीन साहित्य का महत्व समाज में बहुत खास है। उन्होंने गुरु नानक और कबीर जी का उदाहरण देते हुए हमें अपने मंतव्य से परिचित कराया। उन्होंने कहा, ब्रह्म सत्य है और जगत मिथ्या है। कबीर और नानक का उदाहरण देते हुए उन्होंने साहित्य को समाज से जोड़ने का प्रयत्न किया और हमें छोटे से छोटे साहित्य की भीतर छिपी हुई गंभीर समस्याओं से अवगत कराने की कोशिश की। तृतीय दिवस के सत्र में अंग्रेजी साहित्य, इतिहास, मनोविज्ञान आदि विषयों का संबंध साहित्य से उतना ही गहरा है जितना अन्य साहित्यिक भाषाओं का संबंध साहित्य से है। अंत में मैं सभी का आभार व्यक्त करते हुए अपने वाणी को विराम देना चाहूंगी। धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू केविन, थैंक यू रश्मि फॉर एक्सप्रेसिंग योर व्यूज अबाउट द कॉन्फ्रेंस। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
नमस्कार। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज ऑफ आर्ट्स साइंस एंड कॉमर्स, वी आर डिलाइटेड टू ऑफर अ ग्रैंड वेलकम फॉर दिस वैलिडिक्टरी सेरेमनी। अ वेरी वार्म गुड इवनिंग गैलेक्सी ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअल्स, चीफ गेस्ट ऑफ टुडेज वैलिडिक्टरी फंक्शन ऑनरेबल प्रिंसिपल डॉक्टर एस आर यादव, गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर ऑनरेबल डॉक्टर मोहम्मद कलीम जिया, इन्वाइटेड गेस्ट ऑनरेबल प्रिंसिपल ऑफ द कॉलेज, फेलो पार्टिसिपेंट्स, प्रोफेसर्स, स्टूडेंट्स एंड वेरियस कमिटी मेंबर्स ऑफ द कॉन्फ्रेंस, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर विजय नारखेड़े, हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ स्टैटिस्टिक्स, इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज। इट इज अ मैटर ऑफ इमेंस प्राइड टू स्टैंड हियर बिफोर ऑल ऑफ यू दिस इवनिंग एज अ को कन्वेनर ऑफ द कॉन्फ्रेंस। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ द कॉलेज वी आर डिलाइटेड टू ऑफर अ ग्रेसियस वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू। वी हैव कम टू द एंड ऑफ a memorable 3 days international e-conference, reciprocal interfaces of literature and social sciences, organized by departments of languages and social sciences of our college. Ilm ne deke behrhal sahara mujhko, usne tehjeebo tamaddun ne sawara mujhko, मैं तो साकित था जिया मुझको ये मालूम न था, इल्म कर टू हैव विथ अस ऑनरेबल डॉक्टर कलीम जिया द गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर। इट्स माय प्रिविलेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस हिम। हर घड़ी टूटना बिखरना है, काम मुश्किल है फिर भी करना है, रास्ते में है कांच की दीवार, नूर बनकर मगर गुजरना है, नूर बनकर मगर गुजरना है। कलीम साहब, डॉक्टर मोहम्मद कलीम जिया इज एमए इन 3 subjects, उर्दू, अरेबिक and Persian. He has done his PhD in Urdu. He is having a teaching experience of about 40 years at UG and PG level. He spent his entire service life in Ismail Yusuf College, in this college, and retired as head department of Urdu. He is PhD guide at Mumbai University as well as at Rashtra Sant Tukdoji Maharaj University, Nagpur. 10 students have been awarded PhD degree under his able guidance. His 13 papers are published in renowned journals. Sir has authored 8 books on Urdu. He has won 18 academic awards. Sir has visited many countries like United States, Thailand, and Saudi Arabia for academic work on travel grant. Sir is a famous educationalist, poet, writer, translator, teacher, and film artist critic. Sir has worked in more than 100 TV serials, films, web serials, and advertisements. And still working in TV serials, films, web series, and advertisements. Sir has attended more than 300 seminars, conferences, mushairas, debates, workshops, and symposium. On behalf of the conference committee, I welcome and thank you, sir, for providing your gracious presence to join us today. May I request Honorable Dr. Kalim Zia, sir, to say few words about the conference.
आदाब रहे जनाब सदर डॉक्टर इशार जादव साहब, मोहतरमा प्रिंसिपल साहिबा, तमाम मंदूबी डेलीगेट्स और इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज के तमाम असातिज़ा, मेरे साथी और दोस्तों, जिस टॉपिक पर मुझे गुफ्तगू करने के लिए मदु किया गया है वो टॉपिक है सोशल साइंसेस और ज़ुबानों के दरमियान रब्त ताल्लुक। ये सब्जेक्ट या ये उन्वान इतना वसी है, इतना वास्ट है कि इस पर शायद मुझे तालिब इल्म घंटों बात कर सकता है। मैं बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ कि मुझे इस वेबिनार में बहसियत मेहमान इजाजी मधु किया गया और मुझसे कहा गया है कि इस टॉपिक पर मैं कुछ बात करूँ। जनाब सदर, दरअसल इंसान और जानवर में एक ही फ़र्क है और वो सबसे बड़ा फ़र्क है ज़ुबान का। समाज किससे बनता है? जानवरों से नहीं बनता। समाज चीज़ों से नहीं बनता। समाज लैपटॉप और कंप्यूटर से नहीं बनता। समाज रेलगाड़ी हवाई जहाज से नहीं बनता। समाज बनता है इंसानों से, और इंसानों की अपनी कायनात में, इंसानों के अपने यूनिवर्स में उनकी अपनी ज़रूरत, उनकी अपनी ख्वाहिश, उनकी अपनी नेसेसिटीज़ क्या होती है, उसके तहत समाज तरक्की करता है। हमने पढ़ा भी है और सुना भी है कि पहले पत्तों पर लिखा जाता था, पेड़ों पर लिखा जाता था, ज़मीन पर लिखा जाता था, पत्थरों पर लिखा जाता था। धीरे धीरे इंसान ने इतनी तरक्की कर लिया है कि शायद इससे पहले इंसान इतना तरक्की याफ्ता नहीं था। मिसाल के तौर पर अब हम ये देखें कि समाज में बहुत सारी चीज़ें होती हैं। एक छोटा सा आदमी जो साइकिल का मैकेनिक होता है, साइकिल बनाता है, साइकिल रिपेयरर होता है, उसके पास जब हम साइकिल लेकर जाते हैं तो उसको हमको ये बताना पड़ता है कि इसमें क्या तकलीफ है साइकिल चलाने में। साइकिल बताते खुद कुछ नहीं बोलती है, बल्कि साइकिल चलाने वाला बोलता है। साइकिल कौन चलाता है? इंसान चलाता है। हाँ, ये अलग बात है कि हर कौम की, हर मुल्क की अपनी ज़ुबान होती है और वही ज़ुबान के तवस्सुत से वो अपनी बात लोगों तक पहुंचाता है। इसी तरह कॉलेज या यूनिवर्सिटी में जब प्रोफेसर पढ़ाने के लिए जाता है तो उसको पता है कि अगर मैं फिजिक्स पढ़ा रहा हूँ और फिजिक्स में अगर ये पढ़ा रहा हूँ मैं कि रोशनी खत मुस्तकीम में सफ़र करती है, लाइट जो है तो एक ही लाइन से चलती है, तो जितने आर्टिकल्स उस प्रैक्टिकल करने के अंदर लगते हैं वो तमाम के नाम तो मालूम होने चाहिए, और मालूम होंगे किससे? जुबान के तवस्सुल से। जुबान एक ऐसा मीडिया है जिसके ज़रिए इंसान अपनी बात, चाहे वो कमज़ोर तरीन इंसान हो चाहे बहुत तनाव ताकतवर हो, उस तक बात पहुंचाने के लिए ज़ुबान का सहारा ज़रूरी है। बग़ैर ज़ुबान के हम तरक्की नहीं कर सकते, कोई साइंस नहीं पढ़ सकते, कोई सब्जेक्ट नहीं पढ़ सकते, ना पढ़ा सकते, ना तरक्की कर सकते। मसलन अगर साइंसदान अगर आइटम बम बना रहे हैं तो वहाँ के तमाम आर्टिकल्स, वहाँ के तमाम बारीक से बारीक चीज़ का नाम होगा, वो नाम किस में होगा? वो उस मुल्क की ज़ुबान में होगा, भाषा में होगा। मतलब भाषा के बगैर तो हम आइटम बम भी नहीं बना सकते। भाषा के बगैर आइटम बम तो बहुत बड़ी चीज़ है, भाषा के बगैर खाना नहीं खा सकते। मसलन अगर आप अपनी बेटर हाफ से कहते हैं कि मुझे खाना दीजिए, या आप किचन में जाकर के ख़ुद खाना लेते हैं और कोई चीज़ नज़र नहीं आती है, तो आपको अपनी ज़ुबान में उसको समझाना पड़ता है कि बीवी फलां चीज़ नहीं दिख रही है, वो कहाँ है? तो भाई चीज़ें क्या हैं? ये इनके नाम हैं जी। नाम कहाँ से आए? ये ज़ुबान में आए हैं। हम ज़ुबान के बगैर चौपाई हैं, जानवर हैं, उनकी अपनी कायनात है। लेकिन हम अगर ज़ुबान का इस्तेमाल नहीं कर सकते तो इसका मतलब हम में और जानवर में कोई फ़र्क नहीं है, और ऊपर वाले ने सिर्फ एक फ़र्क बनाया है, वो लैंग्वेज का फ़र्क होगा। समझते वो भी हैं, जानवर भी समझते हैं, जज्बात एहसास उनके भी होते हैं, हमारे भी होते हैं। मुझे अपनी 40 साल, मैं तो इस मिशन से जुड़ा हूँ 40 साल तक, मैं इस मिशन इसलिए मानता हूँ कि ये प्रोफेशन नहीं है, टीचिंग प्रोफेशन नहीं है, ये एक मिशन है। और मिशन से जब आदमी जुड़ता है तो जी जान से जुड़ता है। मैंने कोशिश की कि जी जान से इस मिशन से जुड़ कर के मैं अपने स्टूडेंट्स को आसमान में चमकते हुए तारों की तरह देखूं, और वो मुझे माशाल्लाह कामयाबी हुई है। पूरे ग्लोब में मेरे स्टूडेंट्स जो हैं बिखरे हुए हैं, और ये देन मेरी नहीं है, देन इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज की है। मैं तो कुछ भी नहीं था इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज में आने से पहले, एक आम आदमी था, छोटा सा आदमी, थोड़ा सा पढ़ा लिखा, मगर इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज में आने के बाद मुझे इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज ने आज उर्दू की कोई बस्ती ऐसी नहीं जहाँ कलीम जिया को पहचाना नहीं जाता है। मगर ये किसकी वजह से हुआ? ये इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज की वजह से हुआ, इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज के प्रोफेसर साथियों की वजह से हुआ, मेरे सीनियर्स की वजह से हुआ, मेरे स्टूडेंट्स की वजह से हुआ। और ये क्यों हुआ? क्योंकि मैं लैंग्वेज पढ़ाता हूँ, ज़ुबान पढ़ाता हूँ, और ज़ुबान है उर्दू। हमारे यहाँ तो 7-8 ज़ुबान पढ़ाई जाती थी, और हर ज़ुबान अपनी जगह पर, और कोई ज़ुबान ख़राब नहीं होती है, ज़ुबान तो ज़ुबान होती है, और ज़ुबान हर ज़ुबान पाक साफ होती है, चाहे हिंदी हो, इंग्लिश हो, मराठी हो, संस्कृत हो, चाहे अरबी हो, चाहे फारसी हो, चाहे दुनिया की कोई ज़ुबान, सारी ज़ुबानें पाक है, कोई ज़ुबान गलत नहीं हो सकती। हाँ, उसको इस्तेमाल करने वाले, मिसाल के तौर पर एक शख्स जब कहता है कुछ अच्छी बात तो वो कहते हैं जनाब अली, अपनी ज़ुबान के हिसाब से कहते हैं आप तशरीफ़ लाइए। अब एक शख्स जाहिल आदमी जो कम पढ़ा लिखा है वो अपने हिसाब से बात करता है जो हमको नागवार गुजरती है, क्योंकि हम में उसमें फ़र्क सिर्फ ये है कि हम थोड़े से ज़्यादा पढ़े लिखे हैं, हम ज़ुबान को समझने लगे हैं। और ज़ुबान को कब समझा जा सकता है? मीर ने एक शेर कहा था, मीर ने कहा था, देखना तकरीर की लज्जत की, जो उसने कहा, तकरीर कहते हैं गुफ्तगू को या स्पीच को, देखना तकरीर की लज्जत की, जो उसने कहा मैंने ये जाना कि गोया ये भी मेरे दिल में है। यानी जो हम कहते हैं ज़ुबान से वो सामने वाले के दिल में उतर जानी चाहिए, यही ज़ुबान है। ज़ुबान तारीख पढ़ाएं, हिस्ट्री पढ़ाएं, जोग्राफी पढ़ाएं, चाहे आप और कोई साइंस पढ़ाएं, केमिस्ट्री पढ़ा लें, आप कंप्यूटर का इल्म दें, किस ज़ुबान में देंगे? आप इशारों इशारों में नहीं दिया जा सकता, फिर हमको बोलना पड़ेगा, हमको लिखना पड़ेगा, तो लिखेंगे क्या? भाषा ही लिखेंगे ना, बोलेंगे तो ज़ुबान ही बोलेंगे ना। तो वो बोलना जो है वो भी जुबान, लिखना जुबान, पढ़ना जुबान, तो जुबान के बगैर कौन सा साइंस, कौन सा अमल जिंदगी का ऐसा है? कोई अमल ऐसा नहीं है। आप चाहे इबादत करें, चाहे झगड़ा करें, आप चाहे किसी से मोहब्बत से बात करें, चाहे आप किसी से दुश्मनी से बात, जुबान का इस्तेमाल अनिवार्य है, नामुमकिन उसके बगैर आप काम कर रहे हैं। यही वजह है कि हम जब भी जुबान का इस्तेमाल करते हैं, हमारी कोशिश होती है कि हम बेहतरीन से बेहतरीन वर्ड्स को इस्तेमाल करें। अल्फाज बहुत हैं, बेहिसाब अल्फाज हैं, लेकिन आपके पास में कितने अल्फाज हैं, उनका इस्तेमाल कहाँ करना है? मिसाल के तौर पर हम रेलगाड़ी को हवाई जहाज तो नहीं कह सकते हैं, मिसाल के तौर पर पानी को हम जहर तो नहीं कह सकते हैं, मिसाल के तौर पर कॉलेज को हम चरागाह तो नहीं बोल सकते जहाँ पर जानवर चराए जाते। फिर हम वो जुबान इस्तेमाल करते हैं जो उसके लायक होती है, उसके लिए सूटेबल होती है। और यही जुबान फिजिक्स पढ़ाने में, केमिस्ट्री पढ़ाने में, सोशल साइंसेस पढ़ाने में, फिर चाहे आप मजहब की बात कर लें, फिर चाहे आप मुल्क की बात कर लें, चाहे जंग व जदाल की बात कर लें, बगैर इसके हम आगे नहीं बढ़ सकते। और याद रखिए, जुबान जितनी मजबूत होगी, जितनी पुख्ता होगी, जितनी स्ट्रांग होगी, आप अपने ख्यालात उतने ही अच्छे तरीके से न सिर्फ पेश कर सकते हैं, बल्कि अगर कोई प्रोजेक्ट बनाना है उस प्रोजेक्ट में भी जुबान का ज़्यादा इस्तेमाल होता है। जुबान क्या है? जुबान दरअसल समाज के की रूह है, और समाज जुबान की रूह है। यानी समाज और जुबान एक दूसरे के लिए लाजिम व मंजूम है। यानी समाज अगर जिस्म है तो भाषा उसकी रूह है, उसकी आत्मा है। अगर ये दोनों को अलग कर दिया जाए तो हम में और जानवर में कोई फर्क नहीं बचेगा। मैं बहरहाल, ये टॉपिक बहुत वसी है, बोलना बहुत चाह रहा था, जी बहुत चाह रहा था, बहुत दिनों के बाद इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज में इस तरह हाजिर होने का हुक्म हुआ था, जी चाह रहा था बहुत बोलूँ। वहाँ के प्यारे प्यारे मनाजिर सब याद आते हैं, सब याद आते हैं। याद उसकी इतनी खूब नहीं मीर बाजा कम वक्त, फिर वो दिल से बुरा याद आ जाएगा। मेरा कॉलेज जिसने कलीम जिया को कलीम जिया बनाया, बहुत बड़ा कारनामा दिया इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज ने। इस्माइल यूसुफ कॉलेज ने पूरे ग्लोब में स्टूडेंट्स को बिखेर दिया है। मेरे भी बेशुमार स्टूडेंट्स रहे हैं जो पूरे ग्लोब में काम कर रहे हैं, और इसी भाषा के तौर से, इसी जुबान के तौर से काम कर रहे हैं। इनमें मामूली चपरासी से लेकर बड़े से बड़ा कंप्यूटर इंजीनियर भी मौजूद है, और सब अपने अपने काम में लगे हुए हैं। ये भाषा की वजह से, जुबान की वजह से है। मैं बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ कि मुझे मेरी बहन आरती नगर शेखर साहिबा ने, मेरे भाई और मेरे दोस्त नारखेड़े साहब ने, और मेरी दोस्ती बहन और मेरी बेहतरीन साथी माधुरी जोशी मैडम ने मुझे मधु किया है, मुझे हुक्म दिया है कि सर आप आइए, आप इसी तवस्तु से, इसी मीडिया से आप आ जाइए तो कम से कम मुलाकात हो जाएगी। मैं आप तमाम का बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ। मुझे ये भी हुक्म हुआ था कि मैं अपनी कुछ दो चार शेर सुना दूँ, तो एक चार पंक्तियाँ जिसको उर्दू में कता कहते हैं या इस्तंदा कहते हैं अंग्रेजी में, वो समाप्त फरमा लीजिए, और उसके बाद में अपनी बात इंशाल्लाह मुकम्मल कर दूँगा। निगाहों में बसाता है, बसा कर छोड़ देता है, निगाहों में बसाता है, बसा कर छोड़ देता है, दिखाता है मुझे जो राह उसको मोड़ देता है, उसे अपनी मोहब्बत का यकीन खुद ही नहीं शायद, उसे अपनी मोहब्बत का यकीन खुद ही नहीं शायद, वो शीशा देखता तो है मगर फिर तोड़ देता है, वो शीशा देखता तो है मगर फिर तोड़ देता है। बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। मैं अपने प्रिंसिपल साहिबा का, तमाम शुरुआत का बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ, और मुझे मधु किया उसके लिए बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ। बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। खुदा हाफिज़। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू डॉक्टर कलीम ज़िया फॉर योर इंस्पायरिंग वर्ड्स। ये बात सही है कलीम साहब कि मोहम्मद कलीम को कलीम ज़िया बनाने वाला इस्माइल यूसुफ ही है। थैंक यू वंस अगेन सर। लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, वी आर डिलाइटेड टू हैव विथ ऑनरेबल प्रिंसिपल डॉक्टर एस आर यादव एज द चीफ गेस्ट ऑफ द वैलिडिटी फंक्शन। आई टेक एन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू इंट्रोड्यूस हिम। मंजिल पे पहुँचने की तलब होती है जिनको, रस्ते पे खड़े होके वो सोचा नहीं करते। डॉक्टर एस आर यादव इज एम ए बी एड एंड पी एच डी इन साइकोलॉजी। He is having a teaching experience of about 40 years at UG and PG at Ferguson College, Pune for 4 years, Ismail Yusuf College for 34 years, Government Institute of Forensic Science, Mumbai for 2 years, Vikas College, Vikhroli as a principal for 2 years. He spent his maximum service life, that is 34 years, at this college, at Ismail Yusuf College, and retired as head department of psychology. Sir is having an administrative experience of 5 years. Currently, he is working as a principal of Oriental College of Commerce and Management, Andheri, Mumbai. He is recognized PhD guide at Mumbai University. His several articles are published in renowned journals. Sir has authored 3 books on psychology. He has been awarded medals by NCC Directorate. On completion of 12 years and 25 years in NCC, sir has completed 25 years in NCC. He has worked on many government committees such as paper setter and examiner at MPSC, Maharashtra Public Service Commission, in charge joint director of higher education, Mumbai region. Sir has worked on many university bodies like Board of Studies, Member of Management Council, etc. Sir has attended many seminars, conferences, workshops, and symposium. On behalf of the conference committee, I welcome and thank you, sir, for providing your gracious presence to join us today. May I request Honorable Principal Dr. S. R. Yadav sir to address this unique virtual conference.
Hello everyone, dear friends. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you at the valedictory session, the last session of 3 days online international e-conference on the very contemporary topic of reciprocal interfaces of literature and social sciences, organized by the Department of Languages and Social Sciences of Government of Maharashtra's Ismail Yusuf College of Arts, Commerce and Science. For organizing such wonderful educational fest, I must congratulate Dr. Swati Wahal, principal and convener of this conference, Dr. Vijay Narkhede, Dr. Madhuri Joshi, Professor Meena Thakur, Professor Tupti Sapkal, and all members of various committees deserve to be congratulated as well for successfully organizing this new format of conference. Maybe due to the COVID-19 situation, it is quite possible for our entire education system to shift online. Well, ladies and gentlemen, for the last 3 days, we have been experiencing and listening to deliberations of eminent scholars from all over India and abroad on diverse topics from the subjects of social sciences and various languages. It has really created an enriching intellectual environment in and around. Most of the deliberations were thoughtfully written and were research-oriented. The presentations were also equally good. It enabled us to share knowledge, enhance common understanding, and build consensus on certain points, as well as no consensus or disagreement on some other points. I think that many of the delegates or speakers could not share their ideas due to time constraints, but that's all right. There is always a next time. We will request Principal Madam to organize one more such conference as soon as possible so that everyone will get chance to express their views and ideas. Well, while talking about the topic of conference, that is reciprocal interfaces of literature and social sciences, certainly, in my opinion, these two subjects or these two fields are closely related and interact with each other. Let us try to understand the basics of literature. According to me, literature is a collection or body of written work that is imaginative, creative, and cognitive in nature. Whereas social science is a systematic and scientific study of human society and social relationships, which is mainly based on experiments and empirical knowledge. Literature and social science complement each other. They go hand in hand, and both arise as a consequence of curiosity. In fact, I would rather say that social sciences provide matter or material to the literators with which they create or produce literature. People of this fraternity, that is writers, novelists, poets, and even reporters, are very smart. They are skilled social observers, and some of these are also skilled painters. They skillfully show reflections of social realities in their writings and paintings. For example, cartoons of R.K. Lakshman or paintings of M.F. Hussain speak a lot about human society and social relationships. They describe social realities in their creation. I would like to state here an example of Dr. Sigmund Freud, a great neurologist turned psychologist and a founder of the School of Psychoanalysis. Dr. Sigmund Freud and his work have been widely used by many writers and playwrights in all languages, including Marathi. On the other hand, Dr. Sigmund Freud himself used Shakespeare's literature in his psychoanalytical theory or psychosexual developmental theory of personality, which is quite controversial. So what I want to point out here is that both the literature and social sciences are interrelated and having reciprocal interfaces. Overall, the conference has been highly successful, productive, that has created curiosity in and excitement in the minds of participants and new upcoming researchers in particular. Perhaps this is what is the objective of any conference. However, I couldn't help but notice some voice disturbances in the communication during the presentations. It might be due to technical problems in instruments. Otherwise, everything was fine and well organized. I congratulate all the deliberates and participants for their success and overwhelming response. I am proud to say here that I have been a part of IY College. I have spent major part of my life serving here, so this is just like a homecoming experience for me. I, being associated with this college, so many years, almost 35 years, I may take liberty to express gratitude for our patrons, higher authorities, who are a source of inspiration. I think their guidance, their support, and every possible help enabled the organizers to carry out the conference successfully. My thanks to all those who are not in the picture but have directly or indirectly helped to make this event a grand success. To conclude, finally, I extend my sincere thanks to the organizers of this conference, Principal Wahula Madam in particular, for inviting me to the valedictory function. Thank you very much.
जीने की तमन्ना है तो लहरों से लिपट जा, हालात के गिरदाब में आराम कहाँ तक। आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू यू फॉर योर एनलाइटनिंग वर्ड्स ऑफ इमेंस नॉलेज एंड एक्सपीरियंस। थैंक यू सर। अ पेसिमिस्ट कंप्लेंस अबाउट द विंड, an optimist tries to change it, and a leader adjusts the sails. The sails for this particular notion were adjusted by a person who is not only a great motivation to all of us, but a visionary and the person who gave us the belief to bring together this event. She is none other than our principal, Dr. Swati Wahul. खामोशी में भी तो मंजर ओ सुहाने देगा, और बोलेगा तो पत्थर को तराने देगा, और बोलेगा तो पत्थर को तराने देगा। To give a red carpet welcome to everyone assembled here, may I take the pleasure of requesting our respected principal madam to welcome the gathering?
Sarvanna manapurvak namaskar. I welcome to the valedictory function of the 3 days international e-conference on reciprocal interfaces of literature and social sciences, our chief guest, Dr. Santosh Jadhav, principal of Oriental College of Commerce and Management, Mumbai, and a guest of honor, Dr. Kaleem Zia, former head of Urdu at Ismail Yusuf College. I welcome all the resource persons, participants, and the faculty of Ismail Yusuf College to the concluding session of our conference. Dr. Jadhav retired from Ismail Yusuf College as an associate professor and head of the psychology department. Sir's contribution to college academics, administration, and to Boys NCC as a CTO of the battalion and major of NCC was immense and can never be forgotten by us. Also, I would like to mention that Dr. Kaleem Zia, who retired as the associate professor and head of Urdu department, that besides the regular teaching, sir inculcated a research culture among the students of Urdu. Dr. Kaleem Zia always made the college proud, as he has been a well-known writer and poet in Urdu, and he has worked on several committees in the University of Mumbai. Dr. Jadhav and Dr. Kaleem Zia's contributions shall always be remembered by the staff and students of the Ismail Yusuf College. I thank you both for accepting our invitation and for your words of guidance and appreciation. At the outset, I sincerely thank our Higher and Technical Education Department, our patrons, for their timely and constant support and the encouragement that has been given to us. I also take this opportunity to sincerely thank all our resource persons for their informative and lucid sessions and for sharing their knowledge, expertise and research work with all the participants of this conference. The conference, through its deliberations on various aspects of literature, has provided platform for new perspectives in humanities. I hope the conference has truly motivated all the participants and shall be helpful in their path of research. I congratulate my entire team at Ismail Yusuf College for successfully organizing this e-conference at such a short notice, and that too during the ongoing stressful situation of COVID-19 pandemic. In fact, I should say that this period of crisis was like a blessing in disguise for all of us. During the period of this world pandemic, several webinars and two international e-conferences have been successfully conducted by us, wherein a lot of knowledge and ideas were shared and exchanged, and speakers, researchers and students all around the globe were brought together in this scientific congregation. A formal vote of thanks will be delivered at the end of the conference, but I would like to mention that I'm extremely pleased by the efforts which have been taken by all my colleagues. I thank Dr. Vijay Narkhede, the head of the statistics department and the co-convener of this conference, for encouraging the staff to take up this task and for conducting timely meetings for this activity. I thank the coordinators of this conference, Dr. Madhuri Joshi and Srimati Kalpana Pavaskar, and all the members of the various committees who fulfilled the duties which were assigned to them in the best possible way. A great responsibility was shouldered by the technical committee. I thank Shri Amol Sonawane, Assistant Professor of Mathematics at Ismail Yusuf College, and all the staff of the Computer Science Department for taking great efforts and handling the technical aspects of this e-conference successfully. I congratulate all the participants, wishing you further success on the path of research. Very soon, we will publish the full-length papers submitted by the participants in the proceedings of the conference with an ISBN number. I feel that by the way of conducting this conference, we have promoted research and academic excellence among the budding researchers and students and have tried to meet the societal needs at its best. I hope that we can conduct many more such events in the future in the interests of the masses. Dhanyavaad.
I am extremely grateful, Honorable Principal Dr. Swati Wahal Madam, for your valuable guidance and encouragement. Thank you, Madam. Kalam desh ki badi shakti hai bhav jagane wali, dil hi nahi dimag mein bhi aag lagane wali. I take this opportunity to thank all the dignitaries for enlightening us with their knowledge and experience. I shower my heartfelt gratitude to our chief patrons, Honorable Sri Udayji Samant, Minister, Higher and Technical Education, Maharashtra State, Honorable Sri Prajaktaji Tanpure, State Minister, Higher and Technical Education, Maharashtra State, Honorable Sri Saurabh Vijay, Secretary, Higher and Technical Education, Maharashtra State, our patron, Honorable Dr. Dhanraj Mane, Director, Higher Education, Maharashtra State, Pune, our principal, Honorable Dr. Swati Wahal Madam, for the encouragement and support. I would love to extend my warm wishes to coordinators Dr. Madhuri Joshi and Srimati Kalpana Pavaskar, organizing secretaries Srimati Meena Thakur and Dr. Trupti Sapkali, organizing committee members, editorial committee members, एडवाइजरी कमिटी मेंबर्स, टेक्निकल कमिटी मेंबर्स, टीचिंग एंड नॉन टीचिंग स्टाफ हु हैव वर्कड हार्ड टू मेक दिस ई कॉन्फ्रेंस अ ग्रेट सक्सेस. अंधकार को दूर कर जो प्रकाश फैला दे, बुझी हुई आस में विश्वास जो जगा दे. जब लगे नामुमकिन कोई भी चीज, उसे मुमकिन बनाने की राह जो दिखा दे, वह है शिक्षा. दुर्गम मार्ग को सरल जो बनाई, चकाचौंध और वास्तविकता में अंतर जो सिखाई, जो न होगा शिक्षित समाज हमारा, मुश्किल हो जाएगा सबका गुजारा, मुश्किल हो जाएगा सबका गुजारा. थैंक यू. जय हिंद. जय महाराष्ट्र.